Welcome everyone to our fourth Join Up program this evening, made possible by Kathy Carpenter D and Peter D of the D Family Foundation. We want to welcome you tonight by starting with our traditional land acknowledgement. In the spirit of healing and education, History Colorado acknowledges the 48 contemporary tribes with historic ties to the state of Colorado. These tribes are our partners. We consult with them when we plan exhibits, collect, preserve, and interpret artifacts, do archaeological work, and create educational programs. We recognize these indigenous peoples as the original inhabitants of this land. So once again, welcome everyone to Horse Traditions in Colorado's African American Communities, sponsored by History Colorado. My name is Tamar McKee, and in addition to coordinating Join Up with my History Colorado colleagues, I hold a PhD in cultural anthropology with the focus on the historical and cultural dimensions of human-horse relationships. I am also a lifelong Coloradoan and horse person, no stranger to rodeos, racetracks, and epic trail rides in my home state. But I have to admit, before connecting with our presenters for tonight's program, I was somewhat a stranger to the deep historic connections between African American communities in Colorado and their equine connections. Each one of these Join Up programs, since we've been doing them since October, has been just such an incredible journey into the heart of each community's relationship with horses. But for some reason, for this month's program, the discovery process has been all the more touching and profound. And honestly, folks, it has everything to do with the beautiful energy and expertise of tonight's presenters. Elise Clark with the Black American West Museum, as well as Marcy Morgantz, Sophie and Juliet Salazar, representing the Nizhoni Equestrian Camp at Lincoln Hills Cares. I also want to thank the folks behind the scenes who made this program possible. Julie Peterson, Marisa Volpe, Terry Gentry, J.R. LaPere, and all the teams that support you folks and the great work that you do. Thank you, everyone. Speaking of teams, I am also joined with my History Colorado colleague this evening, Corey Ayanaji, who will help field your questions in the chat box along with any other online program needs that you might come up. Corey is also joining up as the manager of the Ballantine Gallery at the History Colorado Center in Denver, which is the destined exhibition space for this whole initiative. Thank you, Corey, for being such an awesome colleague to explore all these equine and Colorado-centric possibilities with. So why are we here tonight? For those of you who are just joining this evening, this is the fourth program in a series called Join Up, Exploring Equine Culture in Colorado. On a monthly basis, History Colorado is inviting scholars, equestrians, ranchers, and others to join up for a series of presentations and conversations that will examine different aspects of horse culture throughout Colorado history and the American West for the ultimate purpose of planning an exhibition at the History Colorado Center for 2021. And here we are in that year already. So we kicked off last year in mid-October looking at charro culture in Colorado. Then in early December, we hosted a conversation and storytelling session with members of the Southern Ute tribe. Last month, we made up slightly, but in a good way. We made up for the absence of the stock show, a little less acute, I'm trying to say, with a resounding journey through the history of horses at the National Western Stock Show. Tonight, we have the honor and privilege of watching presentations from two amazing organizations, the Black American West Museum and Lincoln Hills Cares. In addition to each presentation, there will also be some videos, so let's hope technology does well for that. And after each organization presents, there will be an opportunity for the audience to ask questions. Different from previous Join Up programs, we are doing this Zoom meeting style, which means that everyone has access to both video and audio. That means you can ask questions and share stories and impressions both in the chat box, as we've been doing, as well as through your own device. We ask that you please indicate your desire to speak either by requesting permission in the chat box or using the raise hand format at the bottom of your screen or wherever else you might find it in your device, and Corey's here to troubleshoot should you need that. As this is the first time we have attempted this format, We thank you ahead of time for your patience and consideration for the process and of the community of folks gathered here tonight. This is a safe, respectful space for history and horse nerds only. Questions or comments otherwise will be fielded outside the space accordingly. Please also know that this program will be recorded and indexed to serve as information for the exhibition's development. So please be aware of all this archival collection going on as you enjoy tonight's program. If you have any questions or want to share information, but not in tonight's recorded format, please feel free to email us or call instead. That information is on the slide before you. Now, without any further ado, I would like to introduce our first presenter, Elise Clark with the Black American West Museum. So the full name is Elise Clark Gunnels. Elise is a native of Denver, Colorado. Growing up, she loved the stories her parents told about the ancestors and life in enslavement. Raised outdoors, hunting, fishing, learning agriculture gave her a sense of another time. This nurtured her love of history and researching individuals and events of the past. Elise has spent much of her adult life working with children. She was employed by Denver Public Schools and has worked with Special Olympics, Girls and Boys Club, and director of New Hope Baptist Church's Angel Choir. She is a lover of horses and desires to share that love with children in her neighborhood, as she does as a well-loved docent at the Black American West Museum, and as she will do for us tonight as we join up. Elise, thank you so much for being here tonight, and I will turn the screen over to you.
Thank you very much. I'm so proud and humbled to be here to bring this history to life. I bring you greetings from the Black American West Museum and Heritage Center, located at 3091 California Street. Our museum is in the former home of Dr. Justina Ford, an early doctor in the community. She is attributed with delivering over 7,000 babies from 31 different ethnic backgrounds. We invite everyone to come out once the COVID restrictions are lifted and we have finished our improvements. I'd like to take a minute to thank anyone who signed up to help us get the grant that is now improving our museum. This is our location, phone number, and email address. Our story of the West is an American story. This story has been told for centuries. A lot of people don't know about it though. Americans of African descent came to this country. They were herdsmen, and herdsmen are cowboys without horses. And they've existed for centuries. One of the oldest things in our society, in our world, are farmers and herdsmen. And so African people were sought according to their talents and their skills. Some groups were farmers, others like the Fulani Hausu were herdsmen and horsemen. The horse culture of West Africa began centuries ago, even before the famed Egyptian chariots. The Tuareg and the Fulani and the Hausu are all pastoral people. They are known as nomads because they follow their flocks around. The Tuareg are known as the blue people because of this blue indigo cloth that you see in this photograph that they wrap themselves in, the men do. And these people are still fighting for their way of life in Africa. The Nigerian style of horsemanship are some of the I am descended from some of these Nigerian Fulani, Hausa, and Akan people of West Africa. The Fulani, they live in Nigeria, but they also live in Benin and other countries. The horses in their society represent a social status. In their culture, many noblemen would own horses, but they would also be required to raise armies to show loyalty to the kings. Now, thousands of these horsemen come together still today in colorful robes in Durbar, Nigeria. And this is a large, basically military type parade, but they also showcase all their wonderful horsemanship skills. Descendants of these people were brought to this country for their expertise in animal husbandry, horsemanship. As Anglo-Americans moved into Texas, the descendants of these traditional herdsmen and horsemen were brought with them and the skill of their ancestors. In Texas also, you had leftover animals from the Spanish, you know, when the Spanish lived there. And when they would move away or their farms or ranches would fail, the horses and the cattle were left behind. Many of the ranchers in Texas went from rags to riches by collecting these animals. At the end of slavery, many Black men and many Black people were looking for a better way of life. Cowboy jobs was a respectful job, and it added that freedom of the open range, that freedom of moving about that they did not have when they were enslaved. But even more importantly, it gave an opportunity for a Black man to show his skill and trustworthiness as a man. One of the most famous cowboys that they even wrote about back East was Nat Love. He was born in Davison County, Tennessee in 1854. He was born a slave, but after his family's enslavement, they became sharecroppers there on the land of Mr. Love. Well, his father died while plowing a field in their second year of sharecropping. But Nat was a smart boy. He had many enterprises. One was riding horses for 15 cents, and he would break your horse for 15 cents. And this is how he would make money. And he would also lay bets with the white boys around in the community that he could ride certain horses, some he wasn't supposed to. But he came out west in 1869, to Dodge City, Kansas, where he became a cowboy. He's known as Deadwood Dick. And that came from a competition in the Dakota Territory that involved shooting, riding, and other skills of roping and things like that. Nat Love says, out of the 12 cowboys competing in the wild horse race, six of them, of the 12, were Black. He knew that the end was coming, and he began working as a porter for the Denver and Rio Grande Railroad. And he wrote his autobiography of his life and adventures. He was a person who could read and write, which was rare. Jess Stahl is another important cowboy. Born in 1879, his brother Ambrose competed in rodeos all across the country. Sometimes the color of his skin did not allow him to be treated fairly in these rodeos. But the beauty of the West, I always say, is that people look at your character sometimes more than your skin color. And one thing about cowboys, they don't want to win something they didn't earn. So in a couple of these rodeos, the white cowboys got together and gave him prize money. But Jess had his own way of teaching people. He rode the famous bucking horse Glass Eye backwards to mock the judges. And he rode him for more than 8 seconds. And he this became an important piece of their rodeo appearances. And people would come from miles around to see this man ride a bucking horse backwards. And once he did it with a suitcase. Another cowboy, this one buried here in Colorado. Isom Dart was born Ned Huddleston in 1849. As a young boy, he was sent into the Civil War to take care of his owner and other Confederate officers by cooking for them and mending their wounds. At the end of the Civil War, he began breaking horses. He was a great horseman, moved out around El Paso, New Mexico border. He was known as a rustler because he would sell some horses or cattle that didn't belong to him. But that's only between jobs. But at some point, Isom decided this is not the life for him. And he moved up to Browns Park, Colorado. He was touched by the suffering of the people in the community. And so he built a horse ranch and a school for the people in the neighborhood. He would babysit his neighbor's children. And so he built a reputation as a fair and a decent guy. He was murdered by Tom Horn at Browns Park, which infuriated the people in the community because they didn't feel like he deserved to be shot like he was shot. And they built him, they buried him on a lone grave on Highway 72. And this is the grave site that you can see today when you travel on Highway 72 in Rout County. Not only did we have people like Isom Dart, but we also had John Ware, who was born enslaved. After the freedom, he came to Texas and worked on cattle ranches. And he carried cattle along the Western Trail, which led into Colorado and up into Wyoming and Montana. In 1882, he was hired to take a herd of 3,000 head of cattle from the United States into Canada. Now, when he reached Canada, he noticed that they had a need for good hands, good cowboys. So he stayed. He worked at various ranches in the area. And he began going to a roundup they would have where they would collect the strays along the border between the United States and Canada. Well, by that second roundup, he had registered his own brand and he was looking to become a rancher on his own. He started the John Ware Ranch. He married Mary Mildred Lewis and they had 6 children. His ranch was around Millardville in Alberta, Canada. The Calgary Stampede recognized this man as a contributor to their culture in Canada. One of the best cowhands along the Pecos River was a man named Addison Jones. He was what they called, he was very good at topping off horses, which means he broke horses. And he did this until he was 70 years old. One of his most death-defying feats was that he would tie a rope around his hip and corner a horse, either in open plain or in a corral. He would rope the horse. And of course, that horse would take off galloping past him. I don't know how he did it, but with sure determination, he would pull on that rope and flatten the horse to the ground. Do not try this at home. He also headed a black crew of cowboys. Some people did not want black cowboys on their ranches. Some ranches in Texas were primarily all Black, and he happened to head one of these crews. He also moved into New Mexico to do his cowboying, and he worked at many, many ranches there around Roswell, New Mexico. And to show you the respect and the love of this man, when he married, the ranchers around Roswell, being practical, sent them 19 cook stoves. People ask, is there racism? Was there prejudice in the West? Yes, there was. It is America, after all. But different people dealt with it in different ways. We see Jeff Stahl rode his horse backwards. But here we have the Texas kid and Flip, who dealt with it in another way. John Hayes, who was from Waco, is known as the Texas kid. He would look for white only signs outside of saloons and drinking establishments. And then he would go in and try to buy a drink. If you gave him a drink, no problem. But when he was not allowed to drink, he would go outside, get on his horse, ride back into the saloon and shoot out the lights and quickly gallop out of town. But then you had people like Jess Cumbly of Cheyenne, who was 6'4" and 245 pounds. They called him Flip because if he hit you, you usually flipped backwards. The cowboy culture is in transition. The cattle drives didn't last very long because once the railways were established, there was less travel to move cattle. Today, the American rural community has made way for urbanizations. A lot of farms are disappearing. That horse culture struggles to continue their way of life because of the spreading out of urban areas. And for people like me who are descendants of cowboys and farmers and ranchers, we still want to keep this dream alive. And those ranchers still play an important part in everyone's life. Without food, we all starve. So through our family homesteads, rodeos, trail rides, this culture will continue for generations as long as we keep teaching our children. The Bill Pickett Rodeo is an example of keeping that dream and that lifestyle alive. It is one of the only Black-owned rodeos in the United States, touring rodeos, and is named for Bill Pickett, who was born in 1870 in Williams County, Texas. He worked on the 101 ranch in Oklahoma. He taught a young man named Tom Mix how to be a cowboy. Now, Tom Mix went on to Hollywood and became a very famous Hollywood star. But he had this man, he was standing on this man's shoulders. Bill Pickett invented bulldogging, which became a sport, a event in rodeos today. He was a rodeo performer. He was inducted finally into the Pro Rodeo Hall of Fame in 1989. Many cowboys of color were not allowed to ride in mainstream circuits. The Separate But Equal made that law. Bill Pickett is celebrating over 35 years of action-packed rodeo riding. Thank you for your attention. And I recommend The Black West by William Katz, Black, Red, and Deadly by Art Burton. And there are many more out there.
Thank you, Elise. I'm going to get the video primed up that we wanted to share with folks. So folks, we are screening this off of YouTube. So there might be a little bit of delay I will also share in our resource email, post-event resource email as well. But this is a video that's been given to us to show tonight, courtesy of I Am Denver, and I'll let the rest of it speak for itself. And thanks to Elise for making it happen. And let me see if I can get there another way. Here we go. If it'll let me. And 1 second, let me get my screen.
They give my screen back to you?
I'm gonna get it. Yeah, just because I popped around. Let me make sure, here we are. All right. And 1 second, folks. I've got some sound I need to figure out for you. Perfect.
Howdy, everybody, and welcome to the National Western and the African American Heritage Rodeo. Are you ready to have a good time here? Come on, Mia! Uh-huh. Come on, Patsy! Yeah. Do your thing, buddy!
It takes the love of the game and dedication. It's something that it has to be inherent in you. It's something that you really want to do, and you've been wanting to do it for all your life. Cowboys are like your track stars. We're individual competitors, okay? And that's where your dedication, your focus come in, because you're gonna do everything you can in your powers to beat the next man or woman in your particular event. I've been rodeoing for about a little over 35 years. I started after I got a comeback from Vietnam, and I met a gentleman by the name of Henry Lewis. He was an old black cowboy that lived in Aurora, Colorado. And I used to go and help him rope. Next thing I knew, I had a rodeo rig and horses, and That was the beginning of the beginning. When I was growing up, I would always see white cowboys on TV and never saw any African-American cowboys. If we saw an African-American cowboy, he probably was in the role of a chuck wagon cook or something like that. So that was the thing that really sparked my interest. Every time I would go home, my dad and mom, they would say, "You finally found your little niche, huh? You ended up being a cowboy, just as you always indicated when you was growing up as a child." And it was a childhood dream realized. Every dime we make, we have to earn. You earn that by winning shows. You can't win unless your horse gonna put you in a position to win. You got to trust that horse, and that horse got to trust that you're gonna do what you're supposed to do. Beer Money is my new calf roping horse, and it starts a lot of conversation. Every time I say, they say, "What's your horse name?" I say, "Beer Money," and they start laughing. They say, "Why you name it Beer Money?" And I say, "Well, the only money you're gonna win rodeoing is enough money to buy a beer and a hamburger." The cowboy community is really inclusive. Of course, you're gonna have some racism, but for the most part, I never experienced anything like that. I was invited in with open arms. My friends, we went down the road together, that they were all white. And being that I'm one of the few African-American cowboys in Denver, it was just a part of the family. Cowboys is a different breed, what we look at is how competitive you are. The National Western Stock Show is the beginning of rodeo season for the Professional Rodeo Cowboys Association. It's like going to Las Vegas. I mean, you got all the whistles and bells. You got livestock. You got petting zoos. You got people coming from all over the world, all over the country. My first rodeo competition was the Bill Pickett Invitational Rodeo. when I made the Bill Pickett finals, that was, hey, this is the real deal. Bill Pickett is the African-American cowboy who invented the art of bulldogging. He got the idea from watching a bulldog bite a steer on the lip. Now, in today's rodeo, a bulldog is called steer wrestling. And what bulldogging is, you got a hazer and you have the guy that dismounts the horse onto the steer's horn and wrestles him to the ground. And that's the only event in rodeo that they can trace back to its origin. The producer, Lou Bassan, he got this wild idea that he's gonna do a touring black rodeo. And when Lou Bassan brought the Bill Pickett Rodeo to Denver, Colorado, it was an awakening. Okay, it's like, where these guys come from? What? And they were good. Now Lou have since passed away, and we miss him dearly. But we thank him for educating America that African American cowboys have been around for centuries.
When we were enslaved, we managed the cattle on the plantations and ranches in Texas. So back then, the statistic was almost 1 in 3 cowboys was black. Majority of cowhands and ranch hands were of Mexican ancestry, and then you had black ancestry and indigenous people and European immigrants. Maurice Wade helps us to understand that and celebrate that history and look at the diversity of the people that managed the cattle and changed the lives of hundreds of thousands of people throughout the West.
We have people coming up to us all the time telling us even today they never realized there was any black cowboys. In fact, before they started Bill Pickett Rodeo, I thought I was the only black cowboy. Now here in Denver, it's no longer the Bill Pickett Rodeo. Lou was very insistent. He felt that the National Western needed an African-American event in there. And as a result, we have the Martin Luther King African-American Rodeo of Champions.
My name is Savannah Roberts and I'm 12 years old. I've been doing rodeo basically ever since I was about 6, but competing since I was 4.
Here we go. Here is the champion
cowboy. It's really, really, really fun because the people that I'm with, they kind of watch me grow up, and I just know a lot, and it's like a big family that I'm surrounded by. It's only for black cowboys and cowgirls. It's a big rodeo, so that it makes me feel really special. Like some of my friends, they can't do it, so they're always like asking about it.
It's not only the pride that we cowboys feel when we compete at that rodeo, it's the people. When they applaud you, you can feel that pride coming out of them, because a lot of them, they never saw anything like that. That's how it all began for me 35 years ago with the Bill Pickett Rodeo, and I said, man, this is exciting and this is fun, and I met great people, and it's what I wanted to do all my life. After me watching Roy Rogers and the Cisco Kid, Artie Murphy, and all those guys on TV and never seeing an African-American cowboy, this was a dream come true. My name is Maurice Mo Better Wade, and I am Denver.
All right, folks, give me just a moment while I get myself back to all the buttons. I wanna thank Elise again for making that video happen, and actually Maurice Wade as well, who connected us with I Am Denver, and to I Am Denver for being so awesome and willing to let that show at tonight's program. So let me... go here real fast. Thanks, folks. Great. So this is the part where we invite audience questions and impressions. And as Elise knows, I actually have the first question reserved for her. And we talked about this before, but tonight you get to share it with everyone else. I'd love to hear, what do you love about horses? And you're muted, so when you have a moment to unmute.
I love everything about horses. Mm-hmm. I love the way they move. I love their different personalities. And I've always, I don't know, from birth, I've always loved them. I don't remember when I took my first ride, but it's on both sides of my family, both sides of my family. They're cowboys, they're horsemen. As I was saying earlier, on both sides of the family, they have trail riding clubs that participate. And every chance I find, I try to get on a horse. It's just, I don't feel normal without a horse. And so right now I'm not feeling normal because I don't have a horse.
Well, I guess that kind of leads into the next question. What does the world miss without horses? If we had a world without horses, what would we be lacking?
A friendship, a lifelong friendship, because horses live around 30 years. And so you can have a wonderful relationship with the horse. You can go places you can't go by car when you're on a horse. Nothing's better for me when I used to ride and the sun would come up and I would see Brother Fox and Brother Coyote going home and seeing Brother and Sister Antelope coming out. Those are things that you just can't buy, you know, and for children especially, it gives them confidence. And I think the world would be terrible without horses. I'm saddened by what happens to horses today because we don't have the room for the horse. Mm-hmm.
And I know we had one question come up in the chat about, are there any records of joint ventures per se between African American and Latino American cultures? I would say perhaps ranching or rodeo, like what is the crossover? And this kind of speaks to, you know, we had our first program on charro culture and now we're looking at African American culture in the space of horses. Do you know of any kind of crossover?
Actually, we're beginning to work on that again. There was a point that we were participating with the charros. In my neighborhood, we used to have a salsa soul day, and I want to bring that back. Mm-hmm. And that was the blending of Latin and African cultures. We've been united for thousands of years. For over 1,000 years, we've been together. And this is just celebrating that. And hopefully we can bring that back and involve the charros along with Black cowboys. I'd love to see a big parade. That's my dream, is to have a big parade where we see these brown and Black cowboys. George Majunk, yes, I can't ever say his name. He found a stegosaurus. While he was being a cowboy, he was riding around one day and he saw some bones. He investigated and sure enough, it was dinosaur bones. So he was one of the first people around in our area that found these bones. And that's what makes him especially, he's a very special person because not only was he a cowboy, but he became a paleontologist along with that.
That's such an incredible story. Well, thank you so much, Elise. Here, let me turn my video back on so you know you're talking to a real person here, as we have been. I guess I have one more question because we have 2 more minutes according to our schedule here. What is something that you want to talk about that didn't get included in your presentation? We've talked about so much. I can think, you know, any kind of parting thoughts type of question.
I'm looking through some of the comments. I think one of the most important parts is for us to understand that my ancestors weren't brought to this country on a fluke. They knew who they were going to get. There's actually I don't know if you would call it a manual, but they had the different tribes broken down by temperament and skill. And they would suggest which groups were better for which tasks. And since Africa was the first to melt and smelt and use metal, we have groups that were brought because they were metal workers. We have people that were brought because they knew how to farm in tropical settings, which the Europeans were not adept at. So one thing I want everyone to understand, that this is not Black history, this is American history, and that people have contributed to the development and the wealth of this country that are not always recognized, but that's why I'm here. So hopefully we can start realizing how each group has contributed to this country and its greatness.
Thank you so much, Elise. Thank you again for sharing your knowledge and connections about Black cowboys in Colorado and the American West. I know I've learned so much, and I'm certain other folks have here tonight, for that deep history and bringing it up to the present and where we're gonna go from here. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. And so now we're gonna turn to another facet of Colorado's African-American history and contemporary horsemanship with a presentation about the Nizhoni Equestrian Camp at Lincoln Hills Cares. Spearheading this presentation has been Marcy Moore Gantz, who has had a successful career working at the intersection of philanthropy, social justice, and the creative economy. As the CEO and founder of NIA Philanthropy, a social investment and data insights practice, Marcy is a Colorado Trust Fellow and holds an MNM from Regis University. Before founding her practice, she was the deputy director at the Gay and Lesbian Fund, a former program of the Gill Foundation, and deputy district administrator at the Science and Cultural Facilities District, I always just say SFSD, even that's a mouthful, an alumnus of both Leadership Denver and the African American Board Leadership Institution in LA. She has served as a mayoral appointee and on several nonprofit boards. She is also a member of the Community Acts Fund, seated by Tier 1 by the SCFD. Marcy is most passionate about creating economic opportunities for marginalized communities, committed to amplifying women and girls' creative talent and providing entrepreneurship spaces. She is a volunteer and avid supporter of Lincoln Hills Cares. Marcy has also been so kind and amazing in working with her two co-presenters tonight, Sophie and Juliet Salazar, sisters and writers from the Nizhoni Equestrian Camp, who are going to get us started this evening. But first, please allow me to introduce Sophie and Juliet as well. Sophie Salazar is a ninth grader who attends George Washington High School. She attended Denver Language School for Elementary in a Mandarin immersion program. She is fluent in Spanish, Mandarin, and English. She plays the piano and enjoys horseback riding and the beautiful mountains of Colorado. Juliet Salazar is a seventh grader at Denver Language School. She and her sister are both first generation Coloradoans. Juliet is also fluent in three languages, Spanish, Mandarin, and English. She plays the piano and has studied cello as well as voice. She likes hiking and camping in the mountains. Other favorite pastimes include mountain biking and kayaking. She enjoys spending her time with her family and her pet fish, Thunder. Not to be confused with the Broncos mascot, I assume. So just had to throw a horse thing in there. So thank you all for being here this evening, and I'm gonna turn it over to you now.
Hi, I'm Sophie. I'm Juliet. We are both Nizhoni writers. We will be talking about the equestrian program at Lincoln Hills.
But to talk about the present, we must start at the beginning. It all started in the Rocky Mountains in Gilpin County in a place called Lincoln Hills, Colorado. In the 1920s, Denver had a thriving African-American community, mainly in the Five Points neighborhood. Gilpin County was the only African-American mountain resort in the Western United States.
Denver businessmen E.C. Rainier and Roger Ewalt co-founded Lincoln Hills Development Company in 1922. Both African American men purchased over 100 acres, 38 miles west of Denver. The land plots were usually 25 feet by 100 feet and a price ranging from $5 to $100. Many plots were used as campsites. However, some families built rustic cabins.
Yes, the mountains were free, but the establishments for food were neither free nor welcoming. Let's take a trip back in time.
Lincoln Hills, the only summer resort and national playground for our group in the entire Rocky Mountain region.
African American families began buying land and building cabins at Lincoln Hills in the 1920s. Carpenter and builder William Pitts was one of the first.
This place is my grandfather's cabin that he built in 1926. And I think that was to give us a place for black people to go, you know, to because we couldn't go to Estes Park or Aspen or anything like that. But we have had this cabin in the family since 1926. My mother always cooked on the wood stove, but she always let the children just run around and do whatever they wanted to. So the boys would go over the mountains and climb over all the rocks. And we'd go down to the creek. She let us go down to the creek. And then we would just play down there, throw rocks in the creek. And we never had a real fishing pole, but we would make something we called a fishing pole. And just fish in the creek. If we weren't around for dinner time, my mother had a cowbell. And she would ring the cowbell. And when she rang the cowbell, the kids would come off of the mountain and come in for dinner.
I'm 65 years of age, and I have been coming to Lincoln Hills and to this cabin since I was born. You know, I look at my great-grandfather as being a visionary. He had the vision that it'd be important for not only our family, but important for the black culture to have places where they could go to and feel comfortable, safe, and enjoy what I consider to be the American dream.
The property has a central club building and cottages. African American vacationers rode the train from Denver to Rollinsville or traveled by car, free from harassment. They stayed for several weeks or just for the day to enjoy hiking, picnics, fishing in South Boulder Creek, swimming, and other activities. Over the years, Lincoln Hills was at the center of Black culture. The Winks Lodge thrived for several decades as a social and cultural hub with reports of visits from notable jazz musicians and a literary figure from the Harlem Renaissance. It was visited by many famous and influential people who were drawn to the property by its serene natural beauty and the haven it offered.
Can't afford to buy? Let Winks Hamlet put you up in one of his fine summer cottages, Winks Panorama. This mountain resort caters to you and to the stars.
As a child, Linda Tucker Kai Kai spent many summer weekends at Lincoln Hills. Her uncle was Winks Hamlet, who built Winks Lodge in 1928 and ran it with his wife Melba until 1965.
Uncle Link's mission was to make of Lincoln Hills a resort where people of color could come to get a rest from the struggles they were having in the cities, the hard work, the difficulties of often not feeling welcome, of the dangers of being black living in the white cities. They could come here and rest and forget all that.
Among the guests were musicians who came to Lincoln Hills after playing clubs in Denver, including Count Basie, Lena Horne, and Duke Ellington.
usually times when they performed in a town, they had to go to the black neighborhoods to spend the night, maybe in someone's home if there was no hotel. So this was very unique for them too, to be able to come to a place that was dedicated to black people. As a child, I took it for granted. It was a place to go, it was a part of the family, but I didn't understand the historical perspective at the time. It wasn't until much later that I realized that it was extremely unique. And then I started learning about, unfortunately, about racism and what it did and how it impacted people. I could always resort back to memories of just a carefree youth running the hills and no prejudice. It was a time when we just didn't have to deal with that.
Camp Nizhoni was born in 1924, offering a place where African-American girls would have the opportunity to understand and appreciate nature. They were not allowed to attend the Longmont YWCA girls camp back then.
Lincoln Hills, the summer home of the Phyllis Wheatley branch of the YWCA. Here, happy young girls camp, swim, and learn botany, astronomy, first aid, and outdoor survival skills.
Marie Greenwood, the first tenured African-American teacher in Denver, was a camper at Camp Nizhoni in Lincoln Hills for 5 summers and a counselor for 10 more.
I look forward every year to coming up here. I love the outdoors and nature. And I found in Nizhoni the thing that just made me happy. We had a little beach down there. And we would go in the creek. That icy water is one thing you always remember. Some of the girls would stick their toe in and that was it. Others would wade in. I would get down there and get all wet. Ah, I loved it. Most of those girls coming out of the city had never been in the mountains. They'd never known anything of nature. But most of all, it was to give them a chance to be free and have fun and relate to each other and develop friendships. It was really mostly an outlet for our girls that they could have no place else.
That was Miss Greenwood, and those are pictures from her own scrapbook. It was clear that she cherished the summer she spent at the YWCA Nizhoni camp. Denver legendary educator and outdoor enthusiast, Miss Marie Greenwood, spent time first as a young camper, then as a nature counselor, leading hiking, swimming, and other outdoor activities until it closed its doors. She only missed one summer in all of those years. The camp grew in popularity and enthusiastic campers boarded the train from Denver to Pine Cliff for 2 fun-filled weeks of hiking, climbing, swimming, and enjoying the mountain air. The camp offered participants the chance to learn astronomy, biology, and outdoor skills, but closed in 1945 when the YWCA integrated.
Lincoln Hills continued as a place for summer leisure just over the border of Boulder County at Pine Cliff. Over 1,000 lots were sold. Only a few dozen cabins were built at Lincoln Hills. The Great Depression affected the development as buyers could not keep up with the payments on their lots. It closed in 1965, a year after the Civil Rights Act passed.
In early 2000, again, 2 local businessmen created Lincoln Hills Cares. It provides outdoor education and recreation, cultural history, and youth workforce programs. Through various partnerships, serve young people and family who may experience barriers to accessing outdoor experiences.
The current Nizhoni program started in 2013 with a bit of a twist, exposing young girls to a rich history of horseback riding in the African-American community. From farming to leisure, horseback riding is part of the culture in the African American West community.
The program encourages the social and emotional development of youth and teen girls through equestrian training. Each summer, a group of Nizhoni riders is selected to participate in the program, along with exposure to equine culture.
Today's Nizhoni Equestrian Program is hosted at the Lincoln Hills Equestrian Center, a safe and welcoming environment, complete with a full barn, stables, tack rooms, pens, and access to various trails.
Weekly instructional sessions in the summer provide participants with an opportunity to learn various equine care tactics and horseback riding skills while building life skills, emotional awareness, and self-confidence.
Real freedom lies in wilderness, not in civilization, said American aviator Charles Lindbergh. Not many people get the opportunity to really connect with the outdoors, to have the feeling of being free with no restraints. But I have been very fortunate and can say that I have had this opportunity. Lincoln Hills is a very magical place. It was an area where people could go away from the busy city, not have any worries. It was and still is a place where people can become anyone they want to. Over the years, the people have changed, but the feeling has always stayed the same. Nizhoni has given me the chance to ride horses. As someone who was born and raised in Denver, horses were not common. Because of that, I did not grow up near horses and only saw them as animals who would compete in races. But going to this camp has taught me that horses are so much more. Each one having its own personalities and quirks. Each one can have its good and bad days. Now, the first time I ever saw a horse in real life, I was amazed by how big they were and how beautiful they are. But there comes a sort of fear when getting on a horse for the first time. Because I had never been on a horse, we started out slow. First picking out the horse we wanted to ride, I chose a white-colored one named Hoopy. We groomed the horse so they would be ready to ride. Brushing them was very fun and exciting, as I even gave my horse a French braid. Lastly, it was time to get on one of them, stepping on a stool and getting one leg over the saddle, then pulling myself up to get the other foot in its position. Because the horse was so high up, I felt intimidated and wanted someone to hold on to my horse's ropes so my horse wouldn't accidentally run away. We made it to this closed off area where we went in circles. These specific horses were trained to go out in walks, not in circles. This is the main reason why the first time I ever got on a horse, it decided to do something called horse rolling. It was about to get down on a sandy spot and have a good roll. The reason horses do this is to relieve any irritation from sweat or tack. Just as you might scratch after removing socks with elastics or pants with a snug waistband. The wrangler told me to jump off, and without a second's hesitation, I did. Luckily, I landed on a soft spot and had no scratches, but I was terrified, probably acting very dramatically as I said I would only ride the horse if someone was there next to me. For the rest of the camp, it never happened to one of us again. But there was a sort of excitement that went through your body as you rode the horse. And for the rest of the summer, when it was time to choose which horse we wanted to ride, I would always go for Hoopy. As the camp went on, we got to go on trails with better scenery, pretty ones with flowers and greenery. It was then, as I sat on top of my Hoopy, looking at the beauty of the mountains, breathing in the fresh scent, and listening to the sound of horses' hooves on the dirt, that made me fall in love with horseback riding. My sister and I loved this camp so much that we went back the following year. I always chose Hoopy, this time going through rivers and streams all by myself. Lincoln Hills is a place where you can let the adventurous side of you take over. It is a place where you can experience new things and be ready to get out of your comfort zone. It is a place of beauty and excellence. It is Nizhoni.
Each day after lessons, Nizhoni riders participated in outdoor activities, for example, fishing, archery, hiking, and visiting local cultural attractions to learn more about the history of Blacks in the West and Colorado. In the meeting with Miss Greenwood when she was 106 years old, we learned a lot about the experiences of an African-American woman living in segregated times. In one instance, I remembered, she talked about how when she went to a movie theater, she had to buy the tickets in one area, and then she would have to walk to another area to actually watch the movie. Not only this, but when she got to the other building, she had to walk up to a balcony to see the movie. She was not allowed to view the movie in general public. I think this impacted her a lot because even though it was something as insignificant as watching a movie, it was already instilling in her that she was different. This illustrated to me that segregation was everywhere, including water fountains, telephone booths, movie theaters, and schools. We feel really fortunate that we got to meet Miss Greenwood and get a glimpse into her life as the oldest Nizhoni camper. She later passed away in the fall at the age of 106.
Along with the Nizhoni equestrian experience, Lincoln Hills Cares continues to expand its reach by serving a growing number of youth and families, especially those who may experience barriers to accessing outdoor experiences. LHC Pathways is a youth employment program. Teamwork Service Learning Program is a summer intensive focused on environmental conservation and land management. I would like to thank History Colorado for this opportunity. And I would also like to thank the Nizhoni program for giving me the chance to learn about the great outdoors.
I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to participate tonight. I really enjoyed working with Miss Marcy, Miss Tamer, and Miss Corey. I appreciate all the people who tuned in tonight. I hope you have enjoyed this program.
Thank you, Sophie. Thank you, Juliet. It's been just such a pleasure to work with you as well.
Sorry about the technical difficulties. It didn't happen in rehearsal, but you all played it off so well.
It wouldn't be a join-up program without something. So, but this is good. This is so good, especially since we're trying a new program here as well. I want to start off with my two questions. So, what do you love about horses? And you kind of already talked about it a little bit, but maybe you get a chance to expound on it a bit more.
I really like that the horses, they were really common. They had their different personalities. I remember that sometimes we talked about how they had their friendships and like they had their friends that were horses and their like other horses that they were like upset at. I also remember that when we were riding, they would communicate to each other and you could see them, even like their looks, they would turn back and look at each other. I thought it was really cool seeing how they communicated with each other.
I love that.
And then for me, what I love about horses is the like excitement you get every time you ride them. It's very fun. I remember the first time I was like, oh, I don't know if I want to go to the camp anymore, but it was such a fun experience. And if I have the opportunity to do this every single year, I would. Mm-hmm.
How did you first learn of this program?
So it was actually one of my mom's coworkers, and she had sent her daughter a couple of years before us, and she really she recommended the program, so we signed up too.
And when was your first summer?
2019.
Okay. So you got to meet Miss Greenwood at a very special time. How special. I know that really left an impression in all of you, including Miss Marcy. Miss Marcy, how did you learn of Lincoln Hills Cares and come into the fold? I don't know if we've talked about that.
Actually, just through community people I've known mostly all of my life.
And I had some free time and was able to be the program manager for one summer, and was lucky enough to have Sophie and Juliet as part of the rider crew, and watching them grow through it. And then I missed the summer last summer, and seeing them, they've literally transformed into the young women that I thought that they would. When you talk about experiential learning, it really does happen there.
And so I'm going to pose a question. It looks like we got one kind of relating to the history of Lincoln Hills. Are there any original owners of the lots? And I don't know if that's for you or if
Actually, I think J.R. LaPierre, who is really at the center of Lincoln Hills Cares, he's the executive director. I think he might be on the line. J.R., are you on? Would you like to join us?
I am on the line.
Wonderful.
So, great question. I'm not sure if there are any original owners directly on the property itself, which is 100 acres, but there is a gentleman who has a cabin just off the river by the name of Judge Gary Jackson. And he's got a cabin which was passed down from his great-grandfather. His cabin is called the Zephyr View. And the reason it's called that because the train that goes by still to this day is called the Zephyr. And so that's been in his family for many, many years.
And you saw them, I don't know how much of that video, but it was the gentleman with his mother, and that was the actual Zephyr, the red building.
So we have a question for Sophie and Juliet. Based on your experience, are you either of you considering a career working with horses?
I personally would enjoy working with horses and would consider it in the future.
Yeah, same for me. Like, working with horses was such a great opportunity for me, and I would enjoy it as well.
Mm-hmm. And I know that, you know, passing it along to, you know, future generations is, I mean, key to any kind of, you know, cultural system and whatnot. And that's actually something that Elise has mentioned with the work that she does. And I didn't know, Elise, if you wanted to chime in about some of the youth that you have worked with and any sort of outcome, intergenerational transmission of knowledge, to say it as an anthropologist, has happened, just to kind of start weaving in your presentation.
Yes, I work with a program called Little Wranglers, and we teach children to handle horses. So that they're ready when we go out, that they already know kind of their way around horses. I've done this program at Red Shield Community Center. And we took children out. We trained them at the center. And we came in, we did units on how much feed, what horses eat, how you take care of them. About tack and how to be around horses. Then we took them out to the farm and they handled horses and they learned to pony horses and things. Then we brought all the horses to Red Shield, to the Madam C.J. Walker Park, which is right next to the center. And the neighborhood came out. And the children we trained ponied the horses. And they act like they have been doing it their whole life. And a lot of them have never forgotten that. I run into them periodically and they still remember that activity. And so it touches lives. And I'm so happy for these young ladies because they're just getting started and they're going to get addicted. And it's a good addiction because horses love you. They don't judge you. And they know when you're happy and sad. And so just the whole thing of horses is so wonderful. I enjoy teaching it. My daughter rides, my grandchildren, they ride. And so we just keep passing it. It's important.
And kind of along those lines of legacy, we had a question in the chat about do the riders get assigned the same horse year after year? And I know you kind of spoke to that, Sophie, a little bit. And did the horse remember you? Do the horses seem to remember the riders that they go with year after year?
So actually in the camp, we are given like a whole bunch of horses to choose from. And every time we go there, we do get to choose which horse we wanted to go on. I just happen to choose Hoopy every single time because I love Hoopy. But I know my sister, she rode a whole bunch of different horses throughout the camp. And the following year, I like to believe that Hoopy remembered me. But Hoopy is one of the more calmer horses. That's why I always chose Hoopy. So I'm not really sure if it was like recognition or if it was like she was just used to being around people.
I usually find that the horse really starts recognizing you on par with the amount of treats you give them. So if you want a horse to remember you, just remember the treats. And remember to be consistent with them too. That's been my speaking from experience and whatnot. So I'm gonna kind of, I have a couple questions, and folks, please flood the chat. Let us know if you have any questions. I know sometimes it's nice to just have a moderated session as well. But one thing that is really apparent, I feel, in these conversations, both tonight and what we've had, is just this need for space. You know, horses, when you're up in the mountains, Lincoln Hills, the retreat, there was space to ride and to be. And I wanted to kind of have maybe gather some reflections on, you know, why it is still important in this day and age to have the space that horses, but of course more than horses, provide us in terms of nature. And I know, Elise, we've even talked about urban corridors and riding too. So why is it still important to have that space? Space to be.
Space is healthy. To have space to move about is a healthy part to humanity. A lot of inner city youth, especially, who never get out of their neighborhood, I found that they are fascinated when they have the opportunity to be in wide open spaces. I think of how many people have never seen stars. And you can get that when you go on horseback and you're camping out with your horse, and you can lay back and look up at the stars, you know, and see just the beauty of the world. And the more we are confined with no space, the grumpier we are. The wide open spaces give your mind time. Riding a horse allows your mind to be free. You know, and I'm saddened when I see how much space is being taken away. Even in our mountains, there it's hard to find a quiet spot now. And I think to remain Colorado, and I'm a native, so I want Colorado to remain Colorado and remain somewhat wild. We need that space. It's important. And for our environment, if we build too much, we're going to hurt our environment. And it's very delicate. We don't have a lot of water in Colorado. That's the way It is. And we need to be aware of our surroundings and how we are putting pressure on our environment.
And, you know, I know that through conversations with Ms. Marcy, you know, at Lincoln Hills Cares, there is the Nizhoni Equestrian Camp, but so much more is taught there. And, you know, we had a question come in the chat about what it was like to work with the girls. And I know, you know, we talked about the outdoor education, all the activities, but I was wondering if you could kind of share a little bit more about what your experience was like that one special summer with the girls.
Well, we had a diverse group of girls, and most of the time the girls don't really know each other. So we had, and sometimes we have the same, like one or two that are the same. And so you had to kind of think about that norming, storming, performing kind of group thing. So, and then you add the inexperience of even being around a horse and the fear of being around the horse and different levels. The wrangler that we had, you know, she was really conscientious about teaching to the person that knew the least. And so it was really important that we gelled as quickly as we possibly could, that we respected each other's boundaries, that we were on time, that we made the commitment, because we weren't, even though it said the summer, the time was short, right? We didn't have a whole lot of time. We had the mornings with the horses, and then in the afternoons we would do archery or fishing, or we go to the cultural organizations. We started off at the Black American West Museum as an orientation. And I think that was really helpful. And that's when we met Miss Lise, and she just kind of blew our mind, even my mind, because I didn't really realize how rich the cowboy experience was in the African American community. And so, you know, we had some challenges, you know, I have to say, you know, with young girls, at that age, especially when you're throwing something different. Each day we had either something wonderful that happened or some other thing that we had to, as a group, work through. What I thought was most exciting, though, was having the opportunity to visit Miss Greenwood. Miss Greenwood was 106 years old. She literally could recall her childhood experiences at Nizhoni, which we didn't get on tape. And forgive me about the tape, even the filming of it, it was kind of on the spot through the camera. So, but she said one reason why she lived so long was all of her outdoor experiences, you know, that Camp Nizhoni was really at the center of it. And, you know, she's proof that having an outdoor life and being an outdoor enthusiast, she wasn't necessarily on the horses. And so I would say from the outdoor experiential portion, she really said that's kind of why she had such a healthy life. She literally didn't look like she was 106. You saw those pictures with the two girls. She looked like she was in the film. And I think the film was what, 10 or so years ago, mm-hmm. or something like that. Mm-hmm. So they were a wonderful group. I'm sure the group this past summer were wonderful. It's a very intimate setting. And so you have no choice but to be vulnerable and to grow.
I was gonna, if you hadn't said it, I was going to point out in the video that you took that it was remarkable how the same she looked that summer of 2019 compared to her in the video. And in post, I'll be able to splice some of that stuff in so people can really get a chance. And you can also come to the museum itself to kind of see the video in full and whatnot. it is really a testament to what impact her summers and her time there and just the legacy that went forward from there too. We're just about out of time. I wanted to give our presenters, one last chance to say, you know, what's on their heart, what's on their mind, just any sort of, just some space to kind of share out anything you might have not a chance to talk about this evening yet, any kind of rejoinder to what we talked about. I'll just kind of leave it open for Sophie and Juliet or Miss Marcy or Miss Elise to share one last parting thought before I do my final slide.
I just want to say thank you for inviting us. Thank you to JR and the team at Lincoln Hills Cares. They do a lot of background work. They also do it very quietly. They don't boast about the things that they do in the community. And I really appreciate that your organization lifted this story up, because I'm born and raised in Colorado and I had no clue that this resort even existed. And so we appreciate that they're preserving the property and making it accessible to other people. And I'll pass it over to Sophie. And I also have to say, they were brilliant. The technical difficulties were on me, and just so happy that they were available and were able to put their talent on this presentation. So thank you, Sophie and Juliet.
Thank you. Another note about Miss Greenwood, our piano teacher, she's 85 years old, and she tells us stories of when she was younger. And we told her about meeting Miss Greenwood, and she said that Miss Greenwood was her first grade teacher. And I just thought that was really cool.
Thank you so much for everyone who came here, and thank you for giving us this opportunity. I really appreciate it.
I'd like to just say thank you for this opportunity also. I love history and I'm so proud to see these young ladies on here who are being brave and riding horses. I would love to go riding with you guys one time or more than one time. And thank you for History Colorado for bringing the whole horse culture together. I've watched several of these and I have loved everything I've seen. I want to point out that the early horses and cattle that were in Texas and left on the plains are actually a breed of North African cow. And of course the horse, the Arabian being one of the oldest breeds. And how that has just come full circle. The same horses that were out of Africa became the livelihood of people who were descended from Africa. And we don't always know that, but I just encourage people to keep reading, keep learning. Life is a journey and we learn something new every day. I do, and I strive for that. And I just hope everyone strives to learn more and just become this one big happy family. And keep riding horses. Let's keep buying them. Let's keep finding places for them to live. They are a part of us and they deserve a place.
Thank you. You know, I couldn't agree more, and just really appreciate you all so much. I'm gonna make a segue like this. I'm going to say, on the note of always learning, let me pull it up there, that we have our next two join up programs coming up. For next month, we're going to have equine therapy in Colorado. Now, equine therapy is kind of a catch-all for equine assisted activities, learning therapies and whatnot. It should be a really expansive and beautiful program. to look and see how it's done in Colorado. And in April, we are going to talk about the wild horses in Colorado, mm-hmm. and we will have two presentations, two scholars to that effect as well. So really excited for to have these two programs lined up, and then we'll have two more after that. And then folks, we will be done for the program series, this exhibition development program series, but it certainly does not mean the end of any of this learning, sharing, connecting, and relating. So please do join us next month if you can. As I've mentioned before, I will send out a resource email full of the writings, the book recommendations that Miss Elise made and everything. And I just want to thank you all again and again and again, Miss Elise Clark, Miss Marcy Morgans, the sister Sophie, and Juliet Salazar. You have brought so much to tonight's presentation, and we cannot wait to see what inspires in the exhibition itself.